message has gotten me through more challenges than I could count. I used verse 13 as my mantra while I muddled my way through learning how to lead an effective children's ministry. That's the I can do all things phrase. Teaching children was a frightening, daunting challenge for me. The enormity of the responsibility for the lessons I taught was a heavy weight, and my own lack of training for how to do the job well was always in my thoughts. Over and over, I prayed for strength, for wisdom, for inspiration, and mostly for the Spirit to fill in the many gaps as I developed some skills to be better able to serve the children entrusted to me. "Be Sunday school superintendent," they said. "It's the easiest job in the church." "Teach Sunday school," they said. "It's easy." And silently I said, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. With the courage of Philippians 4:13, I even managed to teach the kids to sing Philippians 4:4, "Rejoice in the Lord always." Again, I say rejoice. And you all know how uncomfortable I am singing in front of everyone. But I trusted God for strength and grace and learned to rejoice with those happy children. When this passage comes up in the lectionary, I'm always happy to see it. This week, I was immediately comforted by the very familiar words. They have held such power for me in my life. But I know that there is always more to the message than what is comfortable in a passage of Scripture. So I've been reflecting on what it means to rejoice always. Always is a very big word. It doesn't mean once in a while. It doesn't mean when things are going well. It doesn't mean when you are king of the hill. Always means the good times and the not so good times and the really icky times. Even the really, really, really icky times. So does this passage really say always? Does it mean it? How do we do that? How do we rejoice when the clouds are heavy, the sadness is choking us, and the Spirit is making our legs shake, our breath tremble, and even our minds are in chaos? Are those times included in always? I think rejoicing is the key to getting through and out of those no good, very bad, terrible, never want to be there times. Rejoicing and hope come hand in hand to bring a spark of light to darkness. Rejoicing and hope are like yeast. They expand and make things lighter. Finding something to be happy about is good medicine. It helps to heal fear, sadness, anger. Even physical pain is less when we find a bit of joy and a bit of hope. The amazing, powerful thing about joy is that you can have joy separate from your circumstances. We've had some chances to live in that paradox this year. Losing Bob Geyer, John Lent, and Bob Kidder, we as the Salem family have been through concern, sadness, and great loss as a church. Several of us have also had losses in our families and our circle of closest friends. When we're going through those very difficult times of loss, we share our stories. We recall memories, and we smile. Through our tears, we think about a hilarious memory and we laugh right out loud. We rejoice in the ways our lives have been intertwined and we celebrate the person we're grieving. Even in death, we can find joy within ourselves. We rejoice that our loved one is free from the challenges of physical life. We rejoice in having had them present with us. We wipe our tears and we live with hope. In the tragedies happening around us, we need to do that very same thing. We need to look for reasons to have hope and reasons to have joy. Even just tiny sparks of hope and joy. Little itty-bitty seeds of hope and joy that we can nurture as we navigate the daily news. lives lost, homes lost, refugees everywhere, displaced communities, floods, droughts, fires, wars, rumors of wars, violence all around us, threatening to close in on us. No place feels safe. The world is falling apart. What are we to do? Rejoice. We are to rejoice always that our God is bigger than our problems. Rejoice that our God loves us. Rejoice that our God believes in us enough to entrust creation to our care. Rejoice always, at least a teeny tiny bit. Rejoice. This passage from Philippians is powerful. It reminds us to think about the good things, to dwell on the positives instead of letting ourselves become overwhelmed by the negative surrounding us. When we find ourselves caught in a loop of frightening thinking, or locked in anger, or whatever unpleasant thoughts are controlling our minds, we're to replace those thoughts, those not helpful loops playing in our head, with whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable. If there's any excellence, and if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. In addition to our scripture, I've read some very powerful words of encouragement that have helped me to redirect my focus at various times. There's a poem by St. Teresa of Avila called "Laughter Came from Every Brick." Just these two words he spoke changed my life. Enjoy me. What a burden I thought I was to carry, a crucifix as did he. Love once said to me, "I know a song, would you like to hear it?" And laughter came from every brick in the street and from every pore in the sky. After a night of prayer, he changed my life when he sang, "Enjoy me." What a concept. Enjoy God. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Enjoy God's love, enjoy God's creation, enjoy being valued by God, enjoy being trusted by God to take care of the other people that God loves. Enjoy music and flowers and laughter and art and dance and animals and clouds and sunrises and sunsets. Enjoy God and rejoice. St. Teresa also offered a blessing I have printed and hanging next to my computer at my chiropractic office. It helps me find inner peace, and from peace I can find hope and joy. May today there be peace within you. May you trust God that you are exactly where you are meant to be. May you not forget the infinite possibilities that are born of faith. May you use those gifts that you've received and pass on the love that has been given to you. May you be content knowing you are a child of God. Let this presence settle into your bones and allow your soul the freedom to sing, dance, praise, and love. It is there for each and every one of us. One of my great challenges in life is trusting the future. Trusting that I am doing what I should be doing now to get to where God wants me to be in the future. Trusting that the path I am on is the right one. My friend Julie Kilmer gave me a prayer when I started seminary. It's still hanging on the side of my refrigerator, even though I've replaced the first refrigerator I hung it on. It's Thomas Merton. "My Lord God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I am following your will does not mean that I'm actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does, in fact, please you. And I hope I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I'll never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore, I will trust you always, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. I find it very comforting to know that God knows my motivations and that my desire to walk the right paths is pleasing to God, even if I'm not exactly on the path God has in mind. I can relax, rest in God's love, and rejoice that my intent is my worship, even if my understanding is off. Henry Nouwen is one of the all-time most popular authors of inspirational books for Christians ever. He was a priest, a motivational speaker, a college professor with classes consistently most sought out by students. Yet, he felt lost and out of place in his own life, until he took a temporary assignment at a group home for developmentally and physically disabled adults. There, Henry found his place in the world among the beloved. That's the term he used for the residents, and the term he began using for all of us. In that setting, ministering to those people, Henry was ministered to. His own hurting inner self found healing, hope, and joy. From those experiences, Henry learned one of the most important lessons he ever taught. We are the beloved. God loves us, each of us. Knowing God loves us, how can we help but rejoice? Another very meaningful piece for me, an essay about baptism by David F. Wells called Holiness Baptism. Wells talks about the meaning of baptism, focusing on the story of Jesus being baptized by John in the Jordan River. The closing paragraph of that essay helps me to remember that I am the beloved. This is what baptism is. God places a song in your heart. Your godparents' role is to learn that song so well that they can sing it back to you when you forget how it goes. And this is the song. Heaven is open to you. God's Spirit is in you. You are everything to God. This is the song that makes your heart sing. And what does the song mean? I'll tell you. You are the song in God's heart. And God will never forget that song. Each of these writings, Paul's letter to the Philippians, St. Teresa's words, Thomas Merton's prayer of discernment, Henry Nouwen's reflections on being the beloved, and David F. Wells' reflections on baptism. Each of them are tools in my journey through life. Each helped me to find my calm, to find my security, to find hope and joy, and then to rejoice in being God's own precious. If you don't already have a full tool chest of your own, I encourage you to begin creating one. Print the words that inspire you. Keep them where you'll see them at those times you need a boost. It's true, you are wondrously created to show the world the image of God. How can we not rejoice? Secure in the knowledge and the deep within our being awareness that we are the beloved, that we are adored by God, let us give ourselves the freedom to rejoice. In all circumstances, whether we're on top of the world or whether we're carrying the weight of the world, we are the beloved, created to enjoy God, carrying the song God has placed in our hearts. May we truly believe we are the song in God's heart and rejoice.